Now, 95.9 FM WATD presents Friends with Benefits, exploring relationships, social issues, and life stories. Be a part of the show at 781-837-4900. Friends with Benefits with your host, Brian Stratton.
WATD FM on a Thursday night. Tonight, a special tribute, special show to Lou Soloff, the great trumpeter. It's been around for decades, and we're doing a special show to commemorate the life and times, his history, his great doings. We have many people calling in tonight to give testimonials and talk about Lou as a person and as a professional and one of truly the great trumpet players of all time. Suddenly passed away this last weekend, March 8th, in New York City, where he was from. He's from Brooklyn. Happily on the line, we actually have Bobby Columby, who is somebody who is probably one of Lou's first professional partners. It goes back to before I was even born, in the 60s. Hey, Bobby, how are you?
Nothing like starting a conversation with, my grandmother loved your group.
Well, 5 decades, Bobby, you've been in this business. I hate to be the one to tell you that.
Yeah, no, I every morning I'm reminded of that.
Well, I mean, I'm so glad that you were able to make the show.
The fact that there isn't every morning is good news.
That's right, exactly. And we're so grateful that you were able to make the show tonight for this tribute to Lou. Thought it was very important to do this. We have so many people coming in and giving out their thoughts and you know, stories about Lou. When did you and Lou hook up, and tell us a little bit about that?
Well, officially, musically, our first alliance was in Blood, Sweat, and Tears. But before that, I knew him. God, I was a replacement sub soda jerk at Kutcher's, the Catskill Mountains resort, and he was in the house band, and I was up there as a guest, and someone asked me to fill in as a soda jerk, and that's where I first met Lou.
How old were you at that point?
I think I may have just got out of high school.
Okay, so very young.
And Lou's about a year older than I am, a little less than a year older than I am.
Okay.
But to talk about Lou, it's really, you know, this evening, Thursday night, we could do a tribute to Lou the musician, and Friday we could do a tribute to Lou the person.
No question.
Because on both levels, he was a larger-than-life character. But let's talk about Lou the musician. We would get off the road after an extensive Blood, Sweat, and Tears tour. Then the next night, he'd be playing with Tito Puente, which is an incredible Latin artist. And he had a big band, and those who know that type of music, the trumpet chair, the lead trumpet chair, is an exhausting high note array affair, and it's very, very difficult.
Not many people step up for that
night,
one, sure.
He'd be with Thad Jones and Mel Lewis Big Band at the Vanguard on Monday night. And then you could find him the next night playing with a classical ensemble, like a brass ensemble. He was something. And look, first of all, we're talking about a trumpet. That is not something you do casually if you're a professional. It's a commitment. You have to play every day, and you have to play hours every day. And Lou's philosophy, which was one where he wanted to really be free to improvise and be free to play all types of music, and he might as well play all, you know, with a lot of different people, because he's going to play trumpet every day anyway, so he might as well go out and play with other people. So he was so versatile, and he also played lead trumpet as well as the jazz solo spot, which is in itself unusual because generally the lead player that has all the strenuous upper register stuff, the hard on the lip stuff, and then the jazz player, generally the second or third horn player in a section, it doesn't have to play in that register, but then gets to improvise. Lou did both.
Sure.
Very unusual. As a musician, you know, one of the great trumpet players, and certainly, as far as I know, the most versatile.
Sure. We're speaking with Bobby Columby. He is the original member of the band Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and also now a top manager out in Los Angeles. He manages Chris Body.
And I also produce, actually, which is what I spend most of my time doing.
Which is a career you morphed into, I think, right after Blood, Sweat, and Tears,
during it?
During
yes. Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Yes. So, I mean, you've been quite a musical renaissance man.
Well, I'm not close to what you would a musical renaissance man is really describing Louis.
Yeah, well, that's true. But I mean, as far as you being able to be a survivor in this in this business, especially 5 decades into it, it's not very easy to find a place in every niche of the business, production, performing, and managing. You don't see it very often.
And maybe there's a good reason for it.
Yeah, well, some people like to retire, Bobby.
Yeah, okay.
Right?
Those people. Well, I have two rules of life, which I think Louis probably shared with me. One is only work with people that you would want to have dinner with, you'd go on vacations with, and really spend time with, and then only do a job that you would very secretly do for free.
That's a good point.
And those are the two things you want to go through life, and Louis certainly carried that through.
Now, wouldn't you say Louis was the kind of individual, because I knew Louis too, as
everybody knew Louis.
Everybody
That's
knew
the
Louis.
Point. He was the most lovable.
Likeable, yes.
Likeable. He was childlike in his enthusiasm for everything, for food, for whatever it is. If he would discover something on Friday, by Monday he was an expert.
Yes, he was impassionate about it.
Completely.
Sure. Yes. And does it surprise you?
And also one of the funniest people I've ever met, and I'm going to admit this, he was also the target of just about every practical joke I could come up with.
So let me ask
and
you this.
And good-natured about it.
Let me ask you this. Was it surprising to you? I mean, you were the leader of the band Blood, Sweat, and Tears from really the onset, what, 60?
Not really from the very beginning. I would have to say Al Cooper, at the the first band, I had the idea. I wanted to put a band together. I was a jazz musician wanting to incorporate that into pop music. But from there on, Al was the savvy guy. He understood how to get a record deal. He understood the business. I didn't at all.
So you learned. You took a crash course from Al.
I took a crash course.
Yeah.
And then realized, in my opinion, I didn't think we would be very successful on commercial radio with Al's voice. And I thought that we needed a stronger singer and, some other stuff. And
which you were right.
Well, I was right in terms of we lucked out and everything turned out. And we had David Clayton-Thomas, who has a huge, wonderful voice. And at that time, it was extremely effective with the sound of the brass and our rhythm section. So it was a good combination. But Louis had a lot to do with our success because he was, in my opinion, again, the most credible jazz musician. When he played a solo, there were bebop licks. They weren't, they were spontaneous, legitimate jazz improvised solos. And on Spinning Wheel or Lucretia McEvil and these kinds of songs, he was fabulous. And the average musician would hear that and go, wait a minute, this guy can really play. What's he doing in this band? A lot of attention, and he made us like legitimate, really.
Well, he was certainly the cream of the crop, and as far as Blood, Sweat, and Tears goes.
Well, we had Randy. See, our first band had Randy Brecker, another unbelievably brilliant player. Except Randy, because of the way the band was led at that time, was not given any chance improv. I mean, just four bars here, two bars. It was insane. And that was one of the reasons that I was unhappy with that band, because as great as Randy is, he wasn't given a chance to play.
He was on the bench. Yeah.
Oh, he was really on the bench.
Yeah, and that's unfortunate. But I mean, he had a great brother to join forces with, and before long.
Randy used to tell me the whole time, you know, my brother's going to IU, Indiana. He's really good. I said, oh, that's nice, Randy. I said, no, he's really a good player. I said, yeah, it's great, Randy.
Everybody's got a great brother, right?
You're right.
Yeah, everybody.
So hard to take seriously. But Louie joined the band as both lead and jazz player. And he was... I have a dear friend that actually said Louis Soloff was the Seinfeld of trumpet. His sense of humor, his quirkiness, everybody that knows Lou has an hour's worth of funny stories that they can tell about Lou. I promise you.
And that's why he had a lifetime of friends that continuously kept in touch. Everybody kept in touch with this guy.
And you could meet him for 5 minutes. And I do know people who called me, expressed their condolences, and they would say things like, you know, I met Lou, I loved him, what a great guy. I said, well, how'd you meet him? You know, at a juice bar or something.
Yeah, at a deli.
And I said, really? Yeah. In just 5 minutes. I said, in 5 minutes, you have the memory of meeting him, and you were absorbed with him, and he was wonderful. He had a big heart. Said, yeah, he was great. He could make that impression in minutes.
Bobby, he almost treated everybody the same way. That's really what, I mean, no matter what class of...
he didn't treat young, attractive women the same way.
we'll leave that off of this program.
Other approach.
Yeah, as many musicians do, by the way.
I guess so.
Now, does it surprise you, you were with the band from 67 to...
I remember
60...
speaking about the band, to Benjamin Franklin. Does that give you a little...
Okay. Well, let's say you were there to what, 75? 74?
Yeah, I think 75, beginning 76.
And by the way, some great albums in the 70s, if people ever get onto Amazon, with New Blood, No Sweat. Some great albums, even after...
there are moments on those records. I don't think they were as uniformly as... they weren't breakthrough records at that point.
No, but I mean,
listen. There were already so many bands that were doing kind of that... like fusion-ish thing.
Well, that was the problem, Bobby, is that when those other bands, they started to saturate the market, and Blood, Sweat, and Tears sound now was commonplace.
And you know something? Yeah. There were a lot of Beatle-type bands, too, and then there were the Beatles.
Right.
And I'm not comparing that, Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
I hear what you're saying, right.
But I'm saying some bands can endure, you know, in whole careers, like the Rolling Stones, whole career. It's amazing to me.
It is amazing. Now, did it surprise you that Louis stayed with you from the beginning to the end of...
Well, he wasn't with the beginning. He was with the second band, and that was the band that had the hits.
Right, of course.
And he stayed with us. Well, he stayed with us.
He stayed with you the way through.
I mean, it's not surprising. We had fun, and it was a great gig for anybody.
Well, now, this guy is getting solicited by the likes of Maynard Ferguson.
He's not getting paid the same way he was paid with us.
Okay. Oh,
completely different.
I got
animal.
You. See, there's always a reason behind.
Well, he did. Yeah. I think he studied economics somewhere.
So he was pretty good at the numbers.
Well, he's not going to walk away from that at all. And plus, he would get his profile from Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Plus, he was worth it. Let's face it.
And played in front of more people with Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and that adds something to the job description. You know?
Now, did you follow what he's done the last 10, 20 years?
Oh, no, he's the only member of the band that I stayed in constant touch with.
Okay.
He's, again, it's Louis.
Of course.
He's part of your life.
Right.
And he, I know everything he did. I have all his records, and you know, we spoke all the time, and we'd send each other. I mean, I will tell you a little story that I almost shouldn't tell, but it's
go ahead.
Funny.
We're all friends.
We played Woodstock. We were actually, you know, one of the headliners, and at that point, our career arc, we were at the top of our entire, on the scope of our whole career. That was our highest moment.
I know. I saw the price sheet on the bands that
there you go.
You guys were the highest paid.
And Jimi Hendrix, I think, got paid a little extra. Because he did more than one performance. He did some other stuff.
Okay. You guys were right there, though.
No. We were the highest paid for the one show, absolutely. But let me say, I was not a person that did drugs. by, I mean, not because I didn't either condone it or have an adverse opinion. It was up to, you know, what anyone wanted to do. I just personally was not into it. But at Woodstock, you had almost no choice because you're backstage, you're standing around, they're handing you joints, and I said, no thanks. No,
what's for breakfast? Quaaludes.
Yeah, no, no. Yeah. Yeah, but I kept, you know, rejecting it, and I'm standing next to a row of policemen, and I'm looking at them, and then I finally look at them, you know, and I signal, is this cool? Are you okay with this? And then they're going to, you know, like, we're not going to arrest 500,000 people. I said, oh, I guess. So I started smoking when they handed it to me like a cigarette. I really didn't think much about it, right?
Okay.
Unfortunately, when you smoke about 11 of those little cigarettes, there is an effect.
So I hear, yep.
So all of us in the band, at that moment, somehow, some way, got hooked up with, at the very least, marijuana. So when we played, we weren't great. I don't think as good as we've ever played. In any event, Louis playing his solo on Spinning Wheel. Now, our management did not let the promoters or the filmmakers shoot us because they weren't going to pay anything, and it just, at the time, didn't seem right. So they didn't mix or edit or put anything together with our band, but they snuck some stuff in. They had a camera here and there. In any event, Spinning Wheel was recorded. If you go on YouTube, well, if you listen to the end of Louis' solo, it sort of doesn't make that da 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 da. He doesn't quite hit that note. He reaches for it, he hits it for a half second, then he tries again, and he kind of blurts it out, and then he goes, like that. He kind of quits on it.
A dying quail.
Right,
yep.
Exactly.
Okay.
So no one knew that had been recorded until fairly recently. But I got my hands on a VHS of it. I made an audio recording of it. And on Louis' birthday...
Oh, no.
Yeah, I used to call him. And when he didn't pick up and it went to voicemail, I would just play like the last four bars of the solo and then hang up. I did this for years. Finally, fairly recently, we had a conversation. I said, Louis, did you get those weird phone? He goes, yes! What was that? What? It was me. It was awful. What? And I said, well, Louis, I'm the one that was... He goes, oh, of course, sure, you would do that. I said, I know. It was me. I'm sorry. I said, but at least, look... I mean, you can take away, at least no one really heard that, except for 500,000 people. That was Woodstock. He went, no. I said, oh, yeah.
So like, did you ever get him the actual clip?
I think he found it himself.
Oh, sure, he did after that testimony.
But he's the kind of guy you could do that to.
Oh, of course.
He was so good-natured, and you could have long, practical jokes that would carry on. And we all had those with him. I'm sure if you speak to enough people... Each person will tell their version of a Louis Soloff joke, and I've got 100 more, and they're ridiculous. I mean, they're great.
Well, Bobby, thanks so much for coming on the show. Bobby Columby, one of the founding members of the band Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and Bobby's now in L.A. doing his management gig, and we wish you the best. We're going to be right back with a tribute to Lou on 95.9 WATD FM.
The great Lou Soloff.
95.9 WATD FM. Tonight is a very special night with, we are going over the life and times of Lou Soloff, one of the greatest trumpet players, greatest horn players of all time, and we're so pleased to have David Clayton-Thomas on the line. David was a big part of Lou's life, especially early on with some of the great times with Blood, Sweat, and Tears. David was the lifeblood and vocals with Blood, Sweat, and Tears in the early days, singing songs like Spinning Wheel, Heidi Ho, You Made Me So Very Happy, and When I Die. David, welcome to the show.
Oh, good to talk to you.
Yes, thank you so much. We're talking to David from Canada, as a matter of fact, Toronto, where David lives now. And David, I mean, obviously we all have heavy hearts here about Lou, and it's just a very sudden shock to all, and I'd like to get some of your thoughts and your your feelings.
Well, yes, I was very close to Lou in the early days of the band when we toured relentlessly 250, 300 days a year. For many years, Lou and I were roommates. We used to double up in rooms, and so we got to be very, very close, and that friendship remained right up till the present. He played in Toronto last year, and I went to see his gig, and we had a chance to have dinner together and hang out. He was a truly unique talent.
Yes, by all accounts, we hear, and I knew him personally, of course. He was a very quirky, witty individual.
Eccentric is the word I would use, as most geniuses are.
Yes, and I know you don't throw the word genius out very lightly.
I do not.
He certainly, and I'm sure in your estimation, and I know from the other members of the band, and moving forward, too, into he just was on a long tour with Lou Marini over in Europe. He continued playing, and he was just one of the best of the best, and Blood, Sweat, and Tears gave him that vehicle to really shine and show what he could do early on.
Right. Lou's solo in Spinning Wheel became like a benchmark solo for anybody who came into the band later. You know, if they couldn't cut that solo, especially the double high G at the end of it, then they didn't get the gig. You know, Lou set the bar very, very high.
He certainly did, and of course he was the one that created that. That squeal at the end where it sounded like somebody was getting choked. I mean, how many trumpet players, David, have you heard hit that note?
Maybe him and Maynard Ferguson.
There you go. And that's a class of their own, which Lou actually did play with Maynard also.
Yes, another Canadian and another close friend of mine that's gone.
Yes, it's amazing how many great players went through Blood, Sweat, and Tears that you had the pleasure of working with. But I would have to think that you'd put Lou at the top of the list as far as talent.
Yeah, the original nine-piece band, you know, it's unrealistic to think we were all going to remain friends for the rest of our lives. Guys get married, they start careers of their own, they go in their own directions, and we drift apart. If there was anything positive that came out of Lou's passing, was that we've all been on the phone or emailing each other over the last few days, even people I haven't had any contact with for the last 20 or 30 years. And we've all pulled together because he was universally loved by everybody.
And it's, you know what, that is a lot of the time it's a bittersweet passing, because certainly the whole music community, especially in the Northeast, New York, where Lou has been his whole life, is completely shaken. Completely shaken.
Oh, he was a character. He really was a very unique personality. You know, if I can share a little story of Lou. Back in the day when we were on the road, Lou got it into his head that he had to practice 15 minutes out of every hour, waking hour of the day. So you'd be in the middle of a conversation with him, and all of a sudden his finger would go up, out would come the mouthpiece, and he would be practicing scales, looking at his watch, and when 15 minutes was up, and he'd totally ignore you. I mean, completely, the conversation was completely gone. After 15 minutes, he'd look at his watch, put the mouthpiece away, and pick up the conversation exactly where you left off 15 minutes early. And you had to get used to that with Lou.
So this was common.
The way he was.
Yeah, commonplace. Mm-hmm. We're speaking with David Clayton-Thomas, vocal giant for the band Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and later on, many, many solo efforts. And David, you continue to sing.
Yeah, I have a new album coming out in about 3 months, actually. Not even that, maybe about 3 weeks, I mean. And we've been working on that this winter. And a great creative environment here in Toronto. I know all the musicians. We have the finest jazz players from all over Canada basically congregate in Toronto. So I put together a quintet of five of Canada's top players, and we put together an album of standards. Also, my album, 2010 album, called Soul Ballads, is being released finally in the United States next week.
Wow. So you have distribution throughout the U.S.?
U.S., U.K., and most of the world, actually. It's a company in the U.K. called Fuel 2001, and they have a dozen different labels all around the world. So it's being released internationally.
Well, that's not that's
five
not,
years after it was recorded, but better not, late than never, huh?
Right, that's not bad for this day of age.
No kidding. Well, it was released in Canada in 2010, but just finally got its international release this month.
Now, finally, speaking some final words about Lou Soloff. Lou Soloff, yes. You lived in New York quite a bit. I mean, you just moved up to Canada. I mean, I know you're from Canada, but didn't you, your primary residence was in New York for quite a while?
Yes, for 40 years I lived in New York.
Okay.
Although one of the attractions of New York was that it was just a quick drive up to Toronto or an hour plane flight. And so I was never really far from Toronto. All my oldest friends, guys I went to school with, musicians I've known my whole life, were all here. So I was back and forth all the time. When I finally broke with Blood, Sweat, and Tears, or what was left of it, in 2004, there was no need to live in New York anymore, and I just gave up the place in New York and kept my condo in Toronto.
As far as now, were you far from Lou? I mean, I think Lou was in Brooklyn. Is that correct?
Yeah.
I mean, did you keep up with his inner workings? I mean, I know he worked on so many different projects, and even in the last 10 years, he worked as tirelessly as he did in the 70s.
I mean, there was hardly a year went by that Lou and I wouldn't bump into each other somewhere or get in touch with each other and go grab lunch somewhere. Just a delightful character, one of my favorite people. And it came as a tremendous shock because, as I said, I had dinner with him less than a year ago in here in Toronto, and he was just so full of life and so many things he was doing and wanted to do, yet really excited at that point about going on tour with Lou Marini. And I don't know, of all the guys in that early band, I guess I least expected Lou to go.
Right, and it's funny because so many years have gone by, and the band, you know, most of your bandmates are healthy and happy, and former bandmates, anyways, are healthy and happy and working in music. My friend Fred Lipsius, he's a common friend of yours and mine.
Yes, he is.
Was at Berklee College of Music as a professor for so many years. He'll be on the line tonight again with us, speaking for a few
minutes. Yeah, that's another guy I've stayed in touch with over the years. He and Louie and I were very tight.
Yeah, he actually played me a cut of one of your songs 15 years ago that I guess he came up to your area and you guys collaborated on.
Well, yeah, Freddie did a lot of the arranging, especially on my songs. There were two arrangers in the band, Dick Halligan and Fred Lipsius. Dick did a lot of our cover tunes, you know, God Bless the Child and stuff like that. But I worked very closely with Fred Lipsius on my original songs. We just had a unique chemistry, and he did the arrangement on Spinning Wheel, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, Fred is he's the salt of the earth, and he was a great friend of Lou's, and I know they kept in such close touch, and I know Fred has a lot to say. But I'd like to thank David Clayton-Thomas for joining us for a few moments here on 95.9 WATD for the tribute to Lou Soloff. David, thanks so much, and don't be such a stranger. We're going to get you on the line again after your album comes out.
All right. Well, my condolences to Lou's family, and I know he was a very dedicated, devoted family man, and he will be missed.
What goes up must come down. Spinning wheel got to go round. Talking about your troubles, it's a crying sin. Ride a painted pony, let the spinning wheel spin. You got no money and you got no home.
Spinning wheel. 95.9 WATD. Friends with Benefits here on a tribute to Lou Soloff. And it's been such a great night talking to Bobby Columby and David Clayton-Thomas. I think we have Fred Lipsius on the line. It's Fred, are you there?
I'm here.
Well, thank you so much for participating tonight in the tribute to Lou. I know you were so close with him, and I know such a shock to everybody last weekend, his passing in the music world. People have started, you know, just can't wrap their heads around it, but as it goes now, a lot of people are banding together, especially a lot of your former bandmates in Blood, Sweat, and Tears, Fred.
I was just listening to the show, and
it was pretty interesting hearing Bobby and David. You know, it's like, you know, old times, you know, everybody coming together, like David was saying, you know, it just brings a camaraderie, or, you know, the memories and all that.
Yeah, David was very shook when I spoke with him a couple of days ago. And I know that's something maybe he's you're not accustomed to, is him maybe showing his feelings or whatever.
I can't speak for another soul. And I will not.
So Fred, tell us a little bit. I mean, we have a few minutes here. A little bit of some of your thoughts with Lou. I know you were so close to him even after the days of Blood, Sweat, and Tears. You too. I think he played on some of your solo projects.
Well, just... yes, actually, I was thinking, I forgot about that.
Yeah, I mean,
well, there's so much to, you know, a person's relationship, whether you see them or not. But I met Lou when we were about 17. He just turned 71, and I'm a little older than, you know, less than a year older, at a friend's house, Harry Max, a bass player in the Bronx. And, you know, I guess we liked each other's playing. And a couple of years later, I had a big band rehearsal, something I've just put together of some arrangements I wrote, some of my own tunes, some old standard tunes, just to play. I had a lot of good players in the band. Alan Rubin, Bill Watrous played in the band. Just a lot of people doing shows and all. And
so what year is that?
Trumpet. We have like four great trumpet players. And he played a couple of solos, and... you know, we just kind of kept that alive. I think I might have done a couple jam sessions with Lou. I don't remember that. I'm just picturing the first time I met him over at the house. It's just like you're there at 17 again. And but the major thing was with BS&T, you know, when we were both about, when was that? 67.
Sure, 1967, yep.
And Lou joined the band, like I think Bobby had mentioned, you know, because we had Randy Brecker and Jerry Weiss was playing in the band. And after they left, the band reformed. I was asked to be the musical director or be in charge of the horn section or pick out the set, you know, various things. But Lou joined the band, and... at that time, if I remember correctly, he was doing a new TV show called The David Frost Show.
Okay.
It was pretty hot.
Yep.
Celebrity in New York City. But I sort of don't remember Lou being that interested in joining the band, because really no one had any idea of the success that we were about to have, you know?
Sure.
And but he told me years later that the reason he joined the band was because of the bass player. He wanted to play with Jimmy Fielder, which is pretty interesting.
Jimmy was a great player. Jimmy will love to hear that.
You know?
Yes, he would love to hear that.
Yeah, you as a bass player, we know each other for the listening audience. So
absolutely.
We've played together.
Yes.
But, great. You know, I was reminiscing about Lou in the last couple of days. And the thing that really hit me, was most striking to me personally, I'm sure as the days go on, I might think of some other things. I'm not trying to put one thing more important than the other. For me, what hit my heart was, and Bobby, I think, had mentioned the spinning wheel. Both of them mentioned that. But the idea that we did what happened with Spinning Wheel, that was a pop tune. But in pop music before, I don't think anybody had ever done or arranged for a jazz trumpet solo on a hit song like that. So, I mean, there were always saxophone solos and that, but we played bebop. It wasn't on the hit single, because they just had Steve Katz play about four bars, a shortened-down, watered-down version of that for the hit single, but on the record. So that was very unusual. So I just kind of, thinking back, we both had an opportunity to share something very different, unique, with the world, you know, and to open up a lot of people's ears with big band sound and, you know, that kind of playing, bringing back or bringing jazz. Because from my point of view, I can't speak for Lou, and Bobby was into jazz since he was a kid. We were basically the three jazzers.
Sure.
If I'm not leaving anybody out. And Dick Halligan was more classical, but he started to become a good jazz player as he got into piano and actually a great trombone player and a beautiful voice that
sure.
no one knows. But, so there's a lot of that. And
well, I mean, of course, Blood, Sweat, and Tears at the time was avant-garde. I mean, they were really a sophisticated sound that you didn't hear on the radio. At that point, bands, pop and rock bands, were just throwing little stabs and little corny horn lines in there.
We didn't contrive anything.
No, but
it was all like Steve Katz did what he did, blues and
right, yes.
folk. David sang the way he sang. Dick did his classical arrangements. His first arrangement was God Bless the Child, which I had heard he had asked Bobby or someone, whoever was picking out. Well, Bobby wasn't the only one picking out tunes or making decisions on them, but he said, can I write an arrangement? I didn't even know he was an arranger. I had met him when we were about 19. We played a gig together through a mutual friend. And Dick wrote this beautiful arrangement of God Bless the Child, you know. Regarding Lou's solos, I'm just mentioning, I noticed you were playing tune you had told me when I first met you many years ago, when you came over to my house to meet me and my wife. You said that your dad had played, when you were a little kid, A Look to My Heart, a tune that I had written.
One of my favorites of all time.
Yeah, I think he put you to sleep. He put it in a loop or something. And
it still puts me to sleep, Fred.
Well, in a good way, I hope.
In a
very
good
way. You were playing that at the intermission, or someone was. We did two versions of that. I was looking back at the original record, and it ended the tune that I wrote. It's a short piece, and it's the first version of it was at the end of the first side of a record, not a CD, because you flip the record in those days. I'm forgetting. I'm just thinking CDs now, you know, one side or whatever. But it was the sixth tune, or the last tune on the first side, solo piano, and then we did a duo. Me playing piano, him on trumpet, to end the album for the, I think the 12th tune.
Right, that was what took it out on.
It was like a bookends kind of, almost, although we didn't start it as the number one track. But he played, from what I remember, you know, I'm going back in the memory banks here, I think it was the first take, and he just played, I gave him the music. I don't know if we rehearsed it. He just played, he took a beautiful solo. And, at the end, as I played the melody out, he played a little harmony. It was just very beautiful. And no matter what he played, whatever tune, whatever the mood, particular tune, he was always, what he soloed on, he always caught the mood.
Always captured that moment.
On Lucretia, Bobby had mentioned Lucretia. I call it the ending vamp. A vamp is a musical...
Like a reprise. The reprise?
Yeah, it's like a two... Yeah, they call it Lucretia's reprise. But for non-musical people listening, a musical vamp, for example, is maybe two bars. It just keeps repeating over and over. Some kind of boom, boom, doo doo boom, 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 whatever it is, with a couple of different chords, maybe one chord can be. And so at the recording session, although Dick Halligan wrote the arrangement, great arrangement, I remember being there, and Lou, I was a little far away, although I was a horn player, I was in a different position in this big studio at CBS, and the brass row on the other side from me, and we were vamping out, and as David would just improvise, he might have worked out what he was going to sing on the end, or say, you know, talking to Lucy, you know.
Sure.
And we were just playing this background, bap, bap. Whatever we're playing, just little pecks with the trumpet, brass, and it felt like it needed something else. And although I wasn't in charge, it wasn't my chart, I spoke up, and I just pointed to Lou on the spot as we were recording, and he started to solo. You know, like, do something. And I think maybe we didn't use what he played. I don't remember, but maybe... he might have overdubbed a solo later, but it just instigated that, where he played the solo. Because originally, from what I remember, Dick didn't have a solo in there, and he played a great solo.
That solo was one of the most amazing BS&T solos of his tenure.
Well, I'm just saying, I'm not trying to take credit. I just, I'm trying to talk without it sounding like, you know, we just helped each other with different things. I mean, Dick could have said, I don't want that, and that would have been that. On 40,000 Headmen, I wrote this arrangement.
It was a Stevie Winwood tune, great tune. And Lou played a beautiful solo. Again, it was just, he just fit the mood. It wasn't just like playing a bunch of bebop phrases. It was just very musical for what the tune called for. And then especially one other tune, which I arranged, but I didn't do too much as far as a lot of arrangement in it, a lot of notes and all, Steve Katz's Valentine's Day.
Well, it's so beautiful. And Steve, we want to say hi to Steve. He's in Mexico right now. He really wanted to be on the show today, but he couldn't get there. But anyways, continue.
He was, it's a beautiful tune. I mean, very melodic. And I thought about it because it's not an overpowering solo like all the other things that Lou would do. But he played, and I kind of felt way back then, it was just a feeling, if he put that out as a single, although without Steve singing, if he played the melody in the vein or the flow of the kind of solo that Lou played, it was just very lyrical, melodic, and with nice flowing guitar, you know, just almost reminding of some kind of John Denver kind of stuff or something. I think he could have had a hit and had a whole other success on his own. I mean, it was just a thought. I'm not a producer, but so I just mentioned about three or four different tunes.
Sure. I mean, listen, every tune. Let's face it. Anything he put his lips on, and listen, when you were in the 80s and 90s, I know you did a project with Bernie Williams, former outfielder for the Yankees at one time, right? Didn't you work on that?
Well, Lou played on that. That was for my friend Jack Scarangella, a great drummer that was almost like a son to Buddy Rich.
So it just Lou just continued to
say that again.
Lou just continued to do project after project.
Well, I told Jack about these horns because Jack asked me to write three or four charts out of 12 or 18. And I played sax and piano, and we're very, very close. You have the same birthday. He's 11 years younger. It's like almost a brother. I mean, very close. I just haven't spoken to him for about 3 years, but. When we talk, it's like 2 hours on the phone. But I had suggested for a horn section, you know, Lou and Alan Rubin, and those guys have played on thousands of albums and probably had as many meals together. I'm kidding.
I'm sure.
But anyway, so he was on that album. And also I did an album for a Sweet Basil label, which was in Japan, Japanese label, through Dave Matthews. Not the famous one you know, but someone before him. That's a little older than me, that's in Japan now, but he was a top arranger in New York in the 70s, and he wrote for James Brown and all kinds of stuff that I don't even know. He's a very quick arranger, and he called me to do a project for someone he knew, Masaki Ueda. He's a, like, I'm say this not joking, he's like a soul R&B kind of singer from Japan.
Sure.
My wife knows him. My wife is from Japan. They're from a similar area near Osaka. My wife's from Osaka. And anyway, she knew of him. I think he had a radio show or something, but he was a famous singer. And so he wanted to record with top players here. And Dave Matthews didn't need me to arrange, but he called me. I guess he was busy just producing the album. And I ended up writing charts about all the tunes.
Okay, well.
I mean, he said just write horns for whatever tunes. He sent me a demo of all these things. And it wasn't just to collect money, but I just felt, oh, this could use horns. This could use. So I just wrote a whole bunch of stuff. And Lou was on that. And there's some funny stuff there. Actually, I'm looking at a story.
And you know what? We're up against the clock, unfortunately, Fred.
Okay.
We have a couple of people on the line, but listen, we really appreciate your contribution tonight for a tribute to Lou Soloff. And you're a great guy, a great friend, and we'll be hearing more of your stuff. We'll do some more segues of Fred Lipsius material in the weeks to come.
Anyway, Lou is great, and that's about all.
Thank you so much, Fred. And listen, have a great spring, and we'll see you soon.
Okay, take care.
Thanks so much. 95.9 WATD, Friends with Benefits here. I think we have Jim Fielder on the line. Is Jim on there?
I am here.
Jim, calling from Oregon. How are you?
Yeah, I live in Portland now.
Now, I don't know if you got to hear any of your any of this on the computer.
I did. Yeah, we've been listening to the streaming.
Did you hear what Lou had said about you?
Yeah, Yes.
Wow.
I wasn't going to bring that up.
I'm going to bring it up. I'm jealous.
Because when he first told me that, I couldn't believe it. I was a kid, youngest one in the band, you know, played nothing but rock and folk and, you know, other pop stuff. And so it was quite a revelation to me when he said that, because you know, I came to New York when the band started, summer of 67.
Sure.
And, you know, really didn't have much of an idea about what jazz is. I mean, I'd heard records. I guess the first record I ever bought when I was in high school was Miles Davis's Kind of Blue.
Okay, which is obviously a big influence.
Good place to start from.
Big influence. Hey, Jim, I hope you don't mind, but I think we have Blue Lou Marini on the other line, too. It's going to join in with us. Are you there, Lou?
I recognize that voice.
Hey, man.
What's happening?
How you doing?
I have to introduce Lou Marini, because if you don't know who he is, just listen to some Steely Dan or some old Blues Brothers. I mean, I could read this list, Lou, till I'm blue in the face. I just don't have the time. But boy, you got quite a list. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, I got a nice list going. But you know, let me apologize. I don't know what happened with my phone. It never rang, and I was talking and. Anyway, here now.
Yeah, we had Lou slated for a 9:30 interview tonight, but I guess with the phone lines. Well, but we'll get to this. Let's talk a little bit. We're up against the clock. We have about five more minutes. Why don't we go to Lou's stories? Because I mean, I know Lou Marini was just on tour with Lou just recently.
Yeah, we just played. Since mid-January, we did a big band album for my friend Tom Pearson, who lives in Tokyo. Extremely challenging music, and Louis and I were two of the soloists. And we worked 10 days in a row, rehearsing and recording 6 hours a day. And 3 days later, we left for 18 days in Scandinavia. We played 16 concerts in 18 days. And with our colleague George Wadinius, from Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and we've stayed in touch with him all these years, and he's playing better than ever, and we had a tremendous time together, and in some ways, you know, for Louis and I, it was a big kiss goodbye, but it made it all the more jarring when I found out on Sunday, and I sort of can't believe that I'm not ever going to play any notes with him again, because we had an amazing connection. You know, Steve Katz posted a photo on Facebook a couple of years ago of the two of us on the roof of the place where we rehearsed in Dobbs Ferry, and we have our horns in our hands, and it's obviously we've just taken them out, and we're laughing at each other. It's a beautiful, beautiful photograph. And when Louis said, "I wonder what we are laughing about," I said, "I know what we were laughing about. We were laughing because we just played something out of the blue exactly together, like we've been doing every time we play together since the time we started playing together." And it's true, man. We had some kind of magical connect that just never failed. It happened three or four times on this Swedish tour where all of a sudden we'd hold a note much longer than we ever did before and then cut it off exactly at the same point and look at each other and laugh, you know.
It's such a connection.
Yeah, a real thing.
I mean, if you're not a musician, sometimes you might not get that. But I'll tell you, when you're musical and you have that symmetry with somebody else, boy, is that hard to find. It's very rare. Jim, any quick stories about Lou that you want to get off your chest?
Yeah, the one I cannot get out of my memory. This is in the early days of the David Clayton version of the S&T. We were on the road and sharing rooms. Chuck Winfield and I were roommates back then, but we, after one gig, we got a pizza and brought it up to our room, and Louis came over, and Louis was concerned about his weight at that time. I think someone had told him that he'd better get a handle on his weight because it was starting to get out of control. But of course, Louis he's the closest person I've ever met to what I would call a gourmand. He just he loved food. He just loved to eat. Didn't have to be fancy or anything, as long as it was good. And he loved pizza. And so he's in this quandary. I want to eat this pizza, but I want to start this diet. And so I said, well, Louie, you know, when people do wine tastings, they don't swallow the wine. They just taste it and then spit it out. And he thought for a minute, picked up a slice of pizza, bit it off, chewed it, but did not swallow it. He spit it out into the trash can, and he ate the whole pizza that way. And for some reason, of all the, you know, all the Louis stories I can remember, that is the one that really sticks out in my mind.
As I say
to anyone who asks now, I said, you know, the world is a little less fun now that Louis's gone.
There's no question. And Lou,
you know,
Lou was telling me a story.
We were playing with Steve Tyrell's band, and we came up with the perfect description of life with Louis, and we called it Cirque du Soloff.
Now, Lou, you had told me a story a couple days ago about going out to dinner with Lou for the first course at one restaurant.
Oh, we used to, you know,
tell us
when we were
story.
First in the band, we were so inseparable that we were constantly doing things together. And I remember one night going out to where we had an appetizer at one restaurant, and then we went to another restaurant for the main course and to a third place for dessert, and then we ended up at Ray's Pizza to have a slice at the very end, you know. But, you know, Louis could be, the worst that you could say about Louis was that he could be exasperating, you know. He was stubborn and sort of totally crazy in a way. And at one time, during the same time, you know, not too long after that, we were on tour in Europe, and we were so bugged at each other that we were in London, and one of us was on the elevator, and the other one was standing waiting to check out of the hotel and head down with our luggage, you know. And the elevator door opened, and we looked at each other, and whichever one of us was the one that was outside the elevator wouldn't get on. And we would laugh about, but I'll tell you, man, he and I had some of the greatest mind-boggling laughs of our lives together. I mean, just laugh till you puke, you know. Well, I'm going to miss him.
Gentlemen, thanks so much for being a part of our show tonight, a tribute to Lou Soloff. And we'll hear back from you guys, I'm sure, in the future. Good luck with your individual projects. It's Jim Fielder and also Blue Lou Marini Jr. You're listening to 95.9 WATD, Friends with Benefits. The Wide World of Blues is next, so stay tuned.
Thanks, Brian.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, man.